a fraction of a second to go, the electricity powering your lights, your air conditioning, your television, your refrigerator, nearly everything electric around you right now was water, gas, wind, or some other form of energy, potentially hundreds or thousands of miles away. If you flip a light switch in Los Angeles, that could cause a turbine in Washington to start spinning. Electric grids are considered some of the single largest machines in existence. They stretch across entire continents, but they're machines with absolutely zero slack. With water systems, for example, there's some extra supply in a storage reservoir at the treatment plant, and some extra supply in the pipes connecting the treatment plant to your home. Supply only has to roughly match demand, but that's not the case with electricity. Your lights, your TV, your microwave, everything plugged into the grid uses electricity produced just moments ago. For the sake of example, let's look at what it takes to turn on the lights at the public library in the small town of Glenwood Springs, Colorado. Now, what makes the relatively straightforward task of converting natural fuels or phenomena into electric power difficult is the huge variability in demand from minute to minute and month to month. There are, however, some trends. On an annual basis, the peaks correlate to climate. January represents the winter high water mark as many homes and businesses turn on their electric heating, while July typically ranks highest outright as the country battles summer heat with air conditioners. The month-to-month variations are not that significant, though. The difference between the highest and lowest demand months is less than a third. Most of the variability happens across a given day. In January, all regions of the US observe a two-peak daily demand trend where electricity use spikes around 7 a.m. as people turn up their thermostats and fire up lights and appliances as they wake up and get ready for the day. Then, demand peaks again when people return from work in the evening and do the same. Meanwhile, in July, energy use is highest in the late afternoon or early evening, but this does depend on the region. For example, in the sweltering Southwest, usage peaks around 4 p.m., around the hottest hour of the afternoon when air conditioners have to work the hardest. In the more temperate Northwest, though, which includes Colorado and that Glenwood Springs Public Library, fewer buildings have air conditioning, so demand peaks around 6 p.m., pulled back by post-work use of appliances, lights, televisions, and more. These trends then get further complicated by holidays and special events. For example, on Super Bowl Sunday in the US, demand plummets for a few hours as people turn off the lights, stop cooking, and gather together at others' homes to watch the big game. This is all to say, when forecasting demand, utilities need to factor in the hour, day, season, location, and plenty more. Now, with whatever demand materializes, utilities then need to essentially instantly match supply. To do this, they layer different energy sources on top of each other. Often, the lowest layer is nuclear power. Nuclear power stations aren't designed to be able to turn off and on easily. It would take the better part of a day to shut down and start up again, so it's rather impractical to operate these in response to demand. In addition, considering how massively expensive their construction is, it would be economically inefficient to let these stations run idle. Therefore, they'll run nearly continuously for the entirety of their service lives, except for during planned maintenance. This means they provide the most stable supply of electricity 24/7. Colorado no longer operates any nuclear power plants, but it does have six of the next layer, coal power stations. Like nuclear, most of these coal plants cannot be fired up quickly, as they take some time to get up to temperature, so utilities will also run them essentially continuously. Coal and nuclear combined typically fulfill what's called the baseload. Their continuous production essentially equals the valley of demand. They'll make the minimum amount of power needed at a point in the day. So then, on top of that, utilities need production methods that can fire up and shut down far faster. They need to be able to produce the power to operate all those AC units in hot summer afternoons. The bulk of this job is completed by natural gas-fired plants. Of the 25 in Colorado, 13 of these stations generate using a simple cycle combustion turbine. This is the simplest means of turning natural gas into electricity. Much like a jet engine, the fuel is used to turn a turbine, which turns a generator, which produces electricity. More advanced natural gas power plants recover the hot exhaust to convert it into electricity too, but the startup process for these takes longer, so simple cycle stations are used for applications where speed is key. Most can reach full power within 15 minutes, making them an effective tool to respond to those short peaks in demand. Nuclear, coal, and natural gas are some of the more traditional means of generating electricity. The recent proliferation of renewable energy sources, though, has kickstarted a reinvention of this system of base load and peaker plants. That's because when wind and solar generating stations can make power, that power is essentially free, meaning there's essentially no additional variable cost to generate power once the panels or turbines are installed. That's not the case with natural gas-fired plants, for example, as the gas itself represents one of their primary costs. So this essentially creates a new bottom layer to the energy mix, but it's a bottom layer that's uncontrollably variable. One sunny, windy day could mean that a state has an excess of electricity when added to its base load sources, while one cloudy, windless day could mean that the peaker plants have to operate at full force. Solar and onshore wind power are now some of the cheapest sources of electricity, but because they rely on natural phenomena, they can't match supply to demand the way that the traditional nuclear, coal, natural gas trifecta can. Therefore, grids are being reinvented so that supply doesn't have to match demand, at least minute to minute. Of course, the way to do that is with storage, but storing electricity is not easy. The average American household uses about 30 kilowatt hours of electricity per day. Lithium-ion batteries currently cost around $130 per kilowatt hour, meaning one day storage for one household would cost around $3,900 in batteries. And that's excluding all the additional infrastructure needed to make such an installation possible. Considering the average American household pays less than half of that per year in electricity bills, installing such a system grid-wide would be economically impractical. Nonetheless, Colorado has four battery electric storage systems, albeit at a relatively minor scale. The largest of which is used to power Fort Carson, a U.S. Army base near Colorado Springs. They charge up the 8.5 megawatt battery at night, when electricity demand and therefore rates are low, then use the power during the day when the majority of the base's electricity use occurs. The system's savings should make up for its installation costs in about 13 years, then by the end of its practical lifespan, it's expected to have saved the Army about $500,000 in electricity costs. While such a system can make economic sense for large complexes that can invest in infrastructure that won't pay off for more than a decade, it's just not practical grid-wide, at least right now. Even if there was the battery production capacity to make a meaningful dent in the world's electricity use, the savings just happen too far in the future for most to consider such storage to be worth it. However, for entirely different reasons, in the coming decades, more and more people will be purchasing massive battery packs, the ones inside their EVs. With most forecasts suggesting that some third of new car sales in the US will be electric by 2030, a potential solution to the grid storage need could arise naturally. A Rivian R1T, for example, holds a 135 kilowatt hour battery pack, meaning it could, theoretically, power the average American household for 4.5 days. While EVs typically take in electricity, little stands in the way technologically from them giving that electricity back to the grid. So the idea is that EVs could charge at night or when renewables are performing well, then supply some of that electricity back to the grid during the day while parked and plugged in. In exchange, vehicle owners would be compensated a small amount by the utility company. While the real-world, wide-scale economics have yet to be proven, especially in the face of battery degradation, this vehicle-to-grid concept could potentially play a cooperative role in the transition towards a greener grid. Now, the largest current battery electric storage system in Colorado, the Fort Carson installation, has 8.5 megawatts of capacity. Elsewhere in the state, however, there's a massive, different form of battery that can power over 10,000 homes at once. And it looks like this. Water is one of the earliest forms of energy that humans harnessed, and it still represents one of the best sources of electricity. Hydroelectric power is the best of both worlds. While there's certainly the potential for environmental damage from damming up rivers, the carbon impact is near zero, meaning hydro is green like wind and solar. However, it's also reliable. In theory, hydroelectric dams can start and stop making power in minutes, even if in practice a minimum flow is typically maintained, so they can operate like those natural gas single-cycle peaker plants responding to demand. Of course, there's only so much water upstream, especially in a place like Colorado, which is in the midst of a 20-year-long drought, but hydroelectric dams simply convert potential energy into electric energy. There's no reason why that process can't happen in reverse. That's what happens here, at the Cabin Creek Generating Station. When electricity's cheap, typically at night or when wind and solar are performing at their peak, the facility uses it to pump water to its upper, higher elevation reservoir. Then, when electricity's expensive and in demand, like in the late afternoon, it will start flowing that water through its turbines out into its lower reservoir. It's essentially a form of price arbitrage, but it's one that's already helping smooth out the peaks and valleys of wind and solar power production. Now, no matter how well supply is matched to demand, electricity is of no use to that Glenwood Springs, Colorado library until, of course, it gets there. Many have an image of power plants as something sitting just outside every town and city. While that's how the earliest grids operated, it's hardly the case anymore. Despite dramatic declines in the past decade, some 42% of Colorado's power supply still comes from coal. That means that nearly half of the state's electricity originates from, essentially, just six sites, the state's coal power stations. Therefore, the ability to effectively transport electricity over a long distance is essential. Now, what makes long-distance transmission tricky is simple. The further you send electricity, the more you lose along the way, typically through unavoidable conversion to heat. Meanwhile, the more centralized your electricity production, the less it costs. It's simple economies of scale. Therefore, the task of transmission is all about balancing these competing effects to find an equilibrium. Now, houses, businesses, and other buildings connected to the grid all use alternating current power. A big reason why this standard beat out its direct current competitor in the days of Tesla, Westinghouse, and Edison is because it's relatively easy to convert AC power between higher and lower voltages using transformers. What makes this crucial is that the higher the voltage, the less electricity lost during transmission. Specifically, a doubling in voltage quarters the power loss in transmission. That relatively simple voltage transformation allows for a more efficient electricity distribution system. Colorado's second largest power plant is this, the Crag Generating Station. It connects to some of the state's highest voltage transmission lines, two of which head due south until the town of Rifle. Now, these lines operate at 345 kilovolts, which means that, in theory, over the 75-mile or 120-kilometer stretch from Crag to Rifle, about 3.2% of the electricity is lost, a relatively minor amount thanks to the efficiency of high-voltage transmission. Other more densely populated regions, which need more electric transmission capacity, have even higher voltage lines, all the way up to 765 kilovolts, the current highest voltage transmission standard in the US. Quite few of these lines exist in the US. There's one connecting Quebec to New York State, and then a larger system spanning between Illinois and Virginia. These can carry about six times as much electricity as the 345 kilovolt line between Crag and Rifle, and, thanks to their high voltage, see as little as 0.6% loss per 100 miles or 160 kilometers. That means that, in theory, assuming the infrastructure existed, a 765 kilovolt line could transmit electricity from New York to LA, and about 87% of it would still be there at the other end. That's why these high-voltage lines are becoming more and more common. But what's even more efficient than transmitting an alternating current at a super high voltage is transmitting a direct current. Of course, the difficulty with direct current is that transforming it between voltages is more expensive than with AC, and for use in today's grid, it has to be converted to AC power, which is also expensive. However, compared to the absolute lowest 0.6% loss per 100 miles with the highest voltage AC lines, DC lines see as little as 0.45% loss per 100 miles. Therefore, when there's a need to transmit a huge amount of electricity over a long distance, the economics can work in favor of converting power to DC at its origin and converting it back to AC at its destination. Perhaps the most prominent application of such a system in the US is the Pacific DC intertie, stretching between Northern Oregon and Los Angeles, California. In the summer, the temperate Northwest has relatively little power demand, but generates a huge amount of cheap electricity thanks to its hydroelectric dams. So, the Pacific DC intertie sends this electricity south to power Los Angeles' air conditioners during its hot summer. Meanwhile, in the winter, Los Angeles sees temperate weather and little need for climate control, so it sends its excess electricity north to the Pacific Northwest to power its electric heating. Phenomena like this demonstrate why creating a greener, more efficient grid involves a proliferation of long-distance power transmission infrastructure. It's needed to balance out seasonal trends and to bring power from where it can be produced easily to where it cannot. Back in Colorado, though, its relatively minor 345 kilovolt line from the Crag Power Station eventually enters this more populated area flanking Interstate 70. Here, there are a number of nearby towns that need electricity, but sending 345 kilovolts to each of these would not be efficient. That's simply because the higher the voltage, the higher the construction cost. A 345 kilovolt substation might cost $10.7 million, while a 235 kilovolt one just $7.6. Meanwhile, a 345 kilovolt line costs around $4.5 million per mile to build, while a 230 kilovolt line just $2.8 million. Therefore, even though the transmission losses will be greater, a number of substations around Rifle transform the electricity to 230 kilovolts, and then smaller, cheaper lines carry the flow west, south, and east, closer to its final customers. About 30 miles or 50 kilometers to the east, this line encounters another substation, which steps it down to just 69 kilovolts, and then another yet smaller line circles back towards Glenwood Springs. The power is then stepped down again to 12.47 kilovolts before a final transformer converts it to 120, 240, or 480 volts. The voltage is used by almost all buildings in the US, including the Public Library of Glenwood Springs, Colorado. Unlike with electricity, the supply of domain names is stable. There's only one wendoverproductions.com, for example, even as demand grows and grows. There are now more websites on the internet than ever before, around 2 billion, so if there's even a chance you will want to make one in the future, now is the time to buy your domain before it's gone. Our sponsor, Hover, makes that incredibly easy. Whether you want the domain corresponding to your name, your business, your YouTube channel, or anything else, Hover makes finding it super simple, and you can even get extra creative and stand out with their over 400 domain extensions, like I did with our wendover.productions domain. Plus, with your new custom domain, Hover can set up a custom email address in seconds, meaning you can stand out with a firstname@lastname.com email address, for example. Hover also has super fair, transparent pricing and truly awesome customer support, making them definitively the best place to go to get your domain. There's a reason why I've bought every domain of mine through Hover, and you can too for 10% off by clicking the button on screen or heading to hover.com/wendover, and you'll be helping support the channel while you're at it.